it's rather demanding to be thought of as a superior person in any way, because you have to live up to the reputation, and this sometimes takes a bit of effort. And as a result of this particular group of young men, a sort of more or less organised society was formed, which came to be known as Norman's Earnest Young Men. Certainly the young men were earnest, and I was to a degree, of course. And we discussed all those fascinating questions about the meaning of life and how to solve the problems of the world and all that, which young people like to talk about. Some of these young people have continued their earnestness to this day. One of them was Richard Layard, who's now leading member of the London School of Economics. And I used to give parties. Now, my position was rather slightly anonymous in that I occupied extremely grand rooms, which had quite nice furniture in it, all provided by the college, of course. And yet, of course, my income was practically nothing. So you may well ask, how could I give parties? Well, the answer, I took to making wine. I discovered it was very, very easy to make wine. I found a nice recipe which always had oranges in it and raisins and all sorts of things. And in fact, one of the problems was it was so easy to make this stuff that there came eventually to be a problem about actually getting it drunk. And so I had parties, a great many of them. But I've always been very high-minded, and I couldn't just have a party in order to get drunk, which I'm sorry to say, some people do. My parties always had to have a purpose. On one occasion, I had, for instance, a gibbon party. The dons at King's College, they were all extremely knowledgeable about the works of Edward Gibbon, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. And they used to chant their favourite passages off, and they really did chant them off. You just pressed the button and out it all came. And I won't quote them all, because I can quote quite a few now, but perhaps the best one is the remark about Pope John the 23rd, of whom Gibbon remarks, "The graver charges were suppressed. The vicar of Christ was only charged with sodomy, piracy, rape, arson, and murder." And I thought, having heard all the dons talking about Gibbon, that we would have a Gibbon party. So, aided by Morgan Forster, who was himself very skilled, a knowledgeable scholar of Gibbon, I picked out all the good passages, a number of good passages, and I circulated these in advance. And then when we'd all had several glasses of my home brew, we sat down and one by one we read off these amusing passages. I should say that this is the correct way to approach Gibbon, because Gibbon had an agenda. And when he published the first volumes, he knew he had to get opinion on his side. So his first volumes are very dull. They deal with the history of the coinage and other important scholarly matters that you have to be a specialist to want to read. So if you start reading Gibbon at the beginning, you think, what's it all about? You know, why does everybody think this man is so good? And equally, all the worthy people of his day, having read these, the history of the coinage and so forth, all said what a wonderful historian Gibbon was. And he laid his trap for them, because his agenda was that he was going to attack the Christian religion. But he held that back. And when finally the famous chapter 14, I think it is, was published, they'd all said what a wonderful historian he was, and had a certain problem in saying that he was talking nonsense. The opening of the chapter 14, I hope I can still quote: "The theologian has the pleasing duty of describing religion as she descended from heaven, arrayed in her native purity. The historian has a more melancholy duty and must describe her after a long residence on earth among a weak and degenerate race of beings." Anyway, I got the message, and now what one does, the way to approach Gibbon is to get somebody to tell you where the good bits are, then look in the index and read those particular passages. Another party I had was a book burning. I wonder if they'd be allowed to have that. Now, I did get permission to have a bonfire on the back, not on the back lawn, on what's called Scholar's Piece, the meadow on the far side of the river at King's. And everybody had to bring a book and cast it into the flames, making a little speech about why they had done. So that was very good.